you know, a conductor is able to appeal to the imagination of an orchestra, then they will give him anything. If I had it all to do over again, I would take conducting classes, but not conduct. I just watch. It's like mind control. I'm controlling you with my mind, which is what a conductor does, basically, the good ones.
Welcome to another episode of Contrabass Conversations, your show covering life on the low end of the spectrum. I'm your host, Jason Heath. I am so glad to have you here. And joining me today is Orin O'Brien, the Orin O'Brien. She was hired by Leonard Bernstein for the New York Philharmonic back in 1966. And what a career she has had. And by the way, what a career she had before that. And you know, this is one of those conversations that makes me so grateful to be doing what I'm doing, sitting down and chatting with Orin about all these topics, from excerpts and how different conductors approached different excerpts, what knocks people out of auditions. Orin has listened to every New York Philharmonic bass audition since the 70s. Talk about there's a lot of bass players going through that organization. We dig into some of the conductors out there today and what separates them from the pack. What makes someone like Riccardo Muti so special? This is just such a great conversation. And when I was getting set to chat with Orin, I put out on Facebook that I was chatting with her, and the questions came flooding in. And I thank everybody so much for writing in. I tried to answer as many of them as I could in this interview. And I want to give a special shout out to Chris Mathers, who was Orin's assistant for years and years. We talk about Chris a lot, and Chris gave me some great launching off points for this conversation. And then also Ira Gold. And I think there's rarely a podcast where Ira's name does not come up, but he definitely needs to be mentioned here. He was tremendously helpful. And thank you to the other dozens and dozens of people that wrote in questions for Orin. So really, this is the bass community chatting with Orin through my voice. Hope you enjoy this wonderful conversation with New York Philharmonic bassist and Manhattan School of Music bass teacher Orin O'Brien. Orin, how are you doing?
I'm nervous. How are you?
I'm nervous talking to you. That's,
really?
That's the other way around.
Is there anything you would ask me that I wouldn't faint on the spot? Well, you know, Chris Mathers has been nagging me for years to do a podcast with you. So I finally took his advice, and I think it's very nice of you to call me.
Oh, well, I'm just so appreciative of you taking the time to chat. It's going to be super fun. And, you know, it was great chatting with him. He and I got together in Prague about a year ago for this.
Oh, my God. Oh, in Prague, the sort of the cradle of German bow.
That's true.
Where if you know the right people, you can see Miloslav Gajdos play and sing per questa at the same time.
funny you should mention that. A really good friend of mine who plays in the Lyric Opera of Chicago, Greg Sarchet.
Did you know that he studied with me at one time?
I did.
Uh-huh. Well, he sent me a video once of when Gajdos got off the plane with jet lag. He came right to his apartment and went to the basement, grabbed a strange bass, and recorded this. And I couldn't believe it. It was such incredible musicianship with a strange bass and with jet lag. Unbelievable, you know? But I mean, if you really know the piece, you should be able to do that. Anybody that attempts to play the first bar of the piece knows how hard it is. So, you know, that's wonderful. That's a wonderful connection.
Yeah, he is such a talent.
And so overflowing with goodness and with cheer and with graciousness and, you know, giving his students everything he can. And that's so wonderful.
And Prague, yeah, it really is. It's this amazing wellspring of double bass culture, and particularly German bow, you know, Pashta and you know, what a wonderful teacher he was there. And mm-hmm. I know people that have worked with him.
I have his LP record, his beautiful Grand Chino. It has a picture of himself playing on the cover on the Grand Chino bass. It's just beautiful.
That was a lot of fun. And that was my first time meeting Chris. And then
oh, really?
Yeah. And and then Ira Gold. I know that you and Ira have known each other.
Oh, yes. Ira. Oh, I admire Ira so much. He loves to teach. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
In fact, one of my students just sent me an email yesterday. He ran down to Washington, D.C. to catch the last day of Ira's bow clinic. So I'm looking forward to hearing. He's got a lesson later in the week, and he's going to tell me all about it, because I invited Ira a couple of years ago to give a clinic for David Grossman's and my students at Manhattan. And, of course, a couple of the other students dropped in to watch and see what's going on, you know. And as a result, Ira got invited to give a master class the following year, where he asked me, I remember he asked me, he said, please, I'd like to give a recital too. Is that possible? So I asked the powers that be at the school, and they said, no, if you're not on the faculty, you can't use our facilities to give a recital. So Ira sneaked something in his master class, which really tickled me. At the end of the class, he said, would anybody here like me to play a Bach suite? And the kids all, yes, yes. So he picked up his bass and his bow and effortlessly played the entire, I think it was the first suite, from memory, with a Baroque bow that he happened to have along with his bass. And it was just beautiful, and it was an example of playing something easily and beautifully with, it looked like, very little effort. You know, one of my favorite sayings is, art is the concealment of effort, and you would never guess who said that. Charlie Chaplin.
Really? Wow.
Isn't that amazing? I thought it was somebody like, you know, Pablo Casals or, you know, Fritz Kreisler or something. No, it was Charlie Chaplin, who, of course, was an artist in his own right. So anyway, Ira just showed that in complete essence was the art of concealing effort. He just made it look completely easy and natural, everything he did. It was just inspirational. The kids were just totally blown away. So I'm a big fan of Ira's.
It's been fun to watch Ira continue to grow and develop as a player. You know, I played with him in a chamber orchestra in Memphis, Tennessee back, over 10, maybe 12, 13 years ago. And I remember, it was more recent than that, but it was right before he won his position in the National Symphony. I remember he playing his excerpts and his solos. And yeah, talk about that. Yeah, that Charlie Chaplin line is totally true for him.
Totally true. And when he gives a class and he goes around to each student and touches their shoulder and says, make sure you're relaxed, and this is when you put your body here, and how the expression of whatever bowing you're doing is echoed in the way you use your body. You know, you don't have to use a lot, but you have to know what part of your arm and fingers come into play to get the best results. Mm-hmm. And Ira's just a magician with that. You know, he's just because he studied it so much and he's fascinated by it. And I love his attraction to teaching and to try to hand on what you know, what he's learned from all the great people that he studied with. And it's so important. Well, I mean, that's what teaching is all about, is handing on all the things that you felt were so valuable that you got and making sure they're passed on to the next generation. That's really what teaching's about.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he was just so full of wonderful things about the time he spent with you. He, Ira, and I, and a couple other people got together for some dinner in Ithaca for the ISB convention, and he was mentioning.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And so I, you know, when we set this up, what I like to do before I talk to someone is, I mean, I go through and I watch everything I can online and read everything, but like Chris and I chatted, and he said, oh, you should talk to Orin about this. And Ira chatted. And I also, I messaged out, hey, I'm going to be chatting with Orin. Anybody have anything they'd like me to dig into? And dozens of people wrote in stuff. And and so I won't bombard you with a million things, but it's kind of fun. I love doing these because it's like, I have things that I think would be fascinating to cover, but it's kind of like the whole bass community has suggested a bunch of things for me. It's kind of a neat thing.
Oh, that's lovely. Chris Mathers and I try to get together at least once or twice a year. He comes over and fixes my computer because I'm a computer dope. I don't know anything, and he knows everything. So, and then we go to dinner, and we talk for 3 or 4 hours. And, of course, what do we talk about? Usually about the students that we had, because Chris acted as my assistant for about 15 years. I would send him freshmen to terrify into listening to me. He would scare them to death with sort of bad cop, good cop. And then they'd come for a lesson with me and be properly prepared, you know. So Chris and I, we just love to talk about teaching and bass and life and music and literature and anything. I mean, Chris is one of the most esoteric people that I've ever met. And he's so brilliant. And, you know, it's fun to talk to him, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. He's obviously a great musician and a great thinker. And then he's done so many things outside of music at such a high level.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Everything feeds into his entire personality. And it's wonderful. It's really terrible, though, because when we get started, it's very hard to stop.
You were on this panel discussion in Brooklyn.
Oh, with Jackie Danilo,
right,
the Brooklyn Museum. And, you know, I didn't want to do that because I'm, as you know, I'm very hard to pin down to any kind of public appearance because I just feel it's enough already, you know, and people, we need to look at new people, you know, they need new ideas, and, you know, I'm kind of old-fashioned. So Jackie pointed out that the woman who sponsors this is a very great philanthropist, and that she and her family, the Sackler family, have endowed museums and programs all over the world, and she wanted to meet this wonderful Mrs. Sackler. And so I said, okay, and if you'll be there, and if you'll get me there, because I don't want to take the subway, and she said, oh, I'll pick you up. So she and the other wonderful musician who has since died, Laura Flax, wonderful clarinetist, and they were friends. She and Jackie Danilo were friends since they were teenagers. So it's a kind of a wonderful thing to have in memory of Laura, that, you know, the way she spoke about her career and how she got started and you know, some of the difficulties and some of the joys, and which, of course, Jackie's had, too. So you saw that, huh?
I did. And I'll make sure when I put this out, I'll put a link out to that, because if people haven't seen it, it's very well done. And
it's interesting.
Yeah, it's very interesting.
I think it's interesting, and the moderator was good. She steered it right, you know?
Mm-hmm.
She had a very, obviously, it was a very experienced person, too, with doing that kind of thing. Because that, like yourself, now, how many years' experience have you had with this?
this may be my 400th interview when I put it out. So.
Well, can I tell you, I have read, I think you used to put them on your blog.
Yeah,
did you print it out?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I read Ed Barker and David Grossman, and I just thought they were marvelous.
Oh,
I just enjoyed them so much.
So this is an idea that Chris had. I would love to. So, I mean, you know, you look at all these people that you, like you mentioned, Bernstein and you name them, right? Zubin Mehta, everybody that's been with the Philharmonic.
Right. Like, listen, you know what I thought I could do as long as you're recording? I can read off a list. I once made a bio. Somebody asked for a brief biography, and I made a one-page thing, and I put at the end, just for my own fun, the listing of some of the conductors I've worked with during the past 60 years.
Oh, that'd be great.
And I wrote partial listing, and this is what I wrote down. Leon Barzan, who was the conductor of New York City Ballet since it started, and also founded the New York National Orchestral Association in 1930, and that he did for 30 years. That was 3 rehearsals a week, 4 to 7, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. You read through the entire orchestral literature if you were accepted in his program. You had to audition for him in October, and you paid $10. That was the dues for the year. And then you just sight read through the entire literature in an orchestra that had 8 basses, 10 cellos, 10 violas, 30 violins, and so on, and 2 of each of the woodwinds and brass. And coaches came from the New York Philharmonic and coached you one of the 3 days. And the Wednesday was from 4 to 7 on NPR. And it was a live broadcast of the rehearsal, and everything was sight reading. It really improved your knowledge of the orchestral repertoire, because you started out with Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Brahms, and, you know, ended up with the Strauss tone poems and all the accompaniments. In the 1930s, he had Myra Hess come and read through all 5 Beethoven piano concertos with the training orchestra, and he had Emanuel Fleurman come and over a period of a month read through all the cello concertos with the orchestra. So you got incredible experience. So I was in that for the first couple of months, and also he was the conductor of New York City Ballet when I was in that. So he and Bernstein, Eric Reinsdorf, Raphael Kubelik, Sir Colin Davis, Leopold Stokowski, Carl Böhm, Sir George Schulte, Pierre Boulez, Fritz Reiner, Sir John Barbaroli, George Zell, William Steinberg, Charles Munch, Eugene Ormandy, Nadia Boulanger, Joseph Cripps, Sergio Zava, Claudio Abbado, Sir Malcolm Sargent, Carlo Maria Giulini, Jerzy Semkoff, Zdenek McCall, Zubin Mehta, Kurt Mazur, and Lorne Mazel. There are only a few of the people I've worked with.
Okay, well, that's a pretty good list.
Yeah. Well, in other words, when I tell my students, do this because, I tell them, you've got to trust me because some conductors are going to ask you to do it this way, and you have to be prepared.
Yeah.
So you have this way, and then you have this other way, but you have to be prepared for both, because it's not enough to know just one way, just one tempo. Or one way of playing is not enough. You have to know a couple different possibilities so you can be flexible.
So if we take a, if we, let's just take a piece, for example, like a one that everybody knows, Beethoven 9, recitative. Here we go with our A, E, down, down, up, down.
Well, it depends on the tempo. And if you are preparing it for an audition, I like down, down, because the conductors that I enjoyed playing it with treated it as something that you sing, like the bass baritone comes in the rest of the movement. Mm-hmm. And you're supposed to have that same really strong beginning. So I know that Zimmerman used to teach it down, down, because you want the upbeat as strong as the downbeat in this case, because it's oh, Freud. You want the sound to be equal, like they're two words of the beginning of the recitative. Because basically, you know, I give my students a couple of pages from another friend of mine, a lovely bass player with a doctorate from Juilliard, a guy named Stephen Sass, has written a thesis on methods of double bass playing from 1500 to 1900, and I asked him, please include a chapter on the genesis of the Beethoven Ninth Recitative. And if you look at the Beethoven conversation books and all the historical biographies and the people that knew Beethoven speaking about that, they mention that Beethoven wanted words written underneath the bass and cello part there so the players would understand what they're supposed to be portraying. Wow. And they're portraying each of the statements of the recitative, each of the seven sections. Mm-hmm. Each one of them is an outburst from the basses and cellos against what the orchestra suggests. You want a bit of the first movement, you know, ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum. No, no, that's not right. No, no, that's not right. I want something else, something more beautiful, more noble about the brotherhood of man. And this goes through each movement being rejected in turn. Mm-hmm. And if you know that, you play it more intelligently, and you also will play it in a more lyrical singing manner. I was taught to play more staccato, and the last 30 years or so, conductors want it more lyrical. So I tell people to prepare it that way for auditions. In other words, you don't want to go so much dee-da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-dee-da-da. That's the way we were all taught, to make it clear. Mm-hmm. But now they want da-da-da-dee-da-da-da-da. They want more lyrical and more legato, more connected, like the human voice. Mm-hmm. And that's the way people do it nowadays. I personally hate the way that some conductors follow the Roger Norrington idea that all the early tempos were faster. Mm-hmm. And I don't believe in that, because after all, Beethoven writes in the part, he said, yes, in the same tempo, but like a recitative. Now, if you've ever played a Handel oratorio or an opera, you know what a recitative is. It's a declamation by a singer of a certain kind of authoritative way of singing and explaining something. And you don't run through it like, da-da, da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da. You know, that's ridiculous. You can't express anything that way. So I like down, down, because it gives you a certain depth of sound and a certain gravity, a certain preparation of the first beat of the second measure. In other words, bum, dee, it should be an equal attack. Naturally, if the conductor is going to go very fast, one, two, ba, ba, then you take up, down. And generally speaking, the bowings are in the part from either the conductor has brought his own parts with him, or it'll be the part that's been used by the orchestra you're playing with for many years, or the principal bass will, in conjunction with the conductor and the first cellist, decide on the bowings. So very often, the only time you have a choice is when you're playing an audition behind a screen, and nobody can tell what bowing you're using. So you use what your teacher trained you with, what you feel comfortable with. I like down, down, because it gives an equality of sound on both of those notes. Yeah. It gives equal heft to both of those notes. And I have to tell you, I have an opinion about every note because of the way Zimmerman taught it to me. You know, he was insistent. One of the things about his teaching that was so unusual for that time was that he insisted, ever since he started to teach, which was in the mid-1930s, he took over the Juilliard position when his teacher, Herman Reinshagen, left because he wanted to go for his health to Los Angeles when he retired. And it must have worked because he lived another 30 years.
Wow.
I think he died in his early 90s, so it worked very well. And he taught the same way. You should play an orchestra part just as beautifully as you play a solo. It has to be prepared with the same care and attention. And Zimmerman was absolutely passionate about that. He had all of his students work on orchestra parts in such a way that you knew what you were doing, and you were supposed to have an opinion about every note. You didn't just gloss through something or flop through it in any old which way. You had to know what your function was at that point in the part and what you were supposed to be doing and how you were supposed to play it. And he was very insistent on that, which I'm grateful about, because I think the same way. You have to prepare things so everything is perfectly prepared and you understand what your purpose is in playing that particular part, whether you're harmony, rhythm, or melody. And very often, we don't have the melody. That's about 10% of the time. And melodies sometimes are legato. Our parts are generally not legato. They're more accented, more clarity, more articulation, more things to go with rhythm and harmony changes than with melody. And you have to play intelligently. You have to play like you're a chamber musician, not just a bass player that's looking at a part. You have to know what else is going on and how to fit into it. Like your part is part of a giant jigsaw puzzle, and you have to know how to play your part properly. You can't play like your part is important when it's pianissimo. You can't play that as loud as the first bassoon solo, or you'd be an idiot. Yeah. And you'd be fired probably.
Yeah.
You know, right. if you play really stupidly, then eventually you don't keep your job. So, you know, it's important for musical and ensemble reasons that you actually know what it is you're supposed to be doing, not just the notes on the page.
Well, you know, and it's interesting, like thinking about that particular passage, like back, I'm sure you've lost track of how many times you've heard Beethoven 9 recit played in an audition.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's just one that people seem to take to such extremes or make it sort of eccentric sometimes when they play
it. Let me tell you exactly what I think about that, because I had that problem when I came to Zimmerman. I was very lucky in my beginning studies. I had 10 years of piano from the ages of 6 to 16 before I started bass. And I also, because my first bass teacher was Milton Kestenbaum, who was at the Music Academy of the West, and he began to teach me after that summer, and I just said, please, will you teach me? I just love to play so much. And, you know, he said, well, I'll try to make time. I'm very busy. Mm-hmm. He played in the studios. He played recordings and television shows. He played You Bet Your Life with Groucho Marx, among a lot of other programs. And he also played a lot of chamber music around Los Angeles. And I asked him once, why didn't you join the LA Philharmonic? You know, you played for so many years in the NBC with Toscanini. He said, I didn't want to play with any conductor other than Toscanini. After Toscanini, most conductors seem rather dull. So now I understand what he meant. I didn't then because I was young and stupid, but I do now. He was the first bass of the Pasadena Symphony. The Pasadena Symphony was a semi-professional orchestra that played one concert a month on a Sunday afternoon and rehearsed every Tuesday night from 7 to 10 in a high school in Pasadena. And Milton played the dress rehearsal in the concert, like many of the other principal players, the principal horn, principal cello, concertmaster, etc. They were all studio players, and the conductor that I was so lucky to work with was Richard Laird, who had studied conducting in Germany and Vienna with Nikisch and Felix Weingartner, who wrote the book on how to conduct Beethoven symphonies that I give to my students when they graduate. And I always tell them, when you read this book, you'll know more than most conductors know. Yeah, it's a secret treatise about metronome markings and certain ways to play certain things that are problematical for conductors, how to understand what the way to handle difficulties, like the beginning of Beethoven's Fifth. A lot of conductors have a lot of trouble with starting that because it's got an eighth rest at the beginning, and it's hard to convince an orchestra how to be together without beating a full bar beforehand, which is very unprofessional. So anyway, so Milton, he said, I think you should be in the Pasadena Symphony and you'll learn a lot. I'm putting you on the first stand with me. Just play the way I play. Copy what I do. Don't ask me any questions. We won't have time for that rehearsal. And I'll explain at your lesson if you need explanation. So I got to sit learning Beethoven symphonies, Brahms symphonies, and the conductor was a godson of Brahms. His father had been one of Brahms's friends, so his middle name was Johannes, Richard Johannes Laird. And he was a fantastic conductor. I learned Beethoven 9th with him, Beethoven 5th, Beethoven 3rd, most of the Beethoven symphonies, all the Brahms symphonies, a lot of concerto accompaniments, overtures. We used to do the second act of Parsifal for Easter when other groups were doing the Messiah or something like that. Of course, we did that too at Christmas time. But I mean, he was wonderful musician with the history of having been a friend and a colleague of Richard Strauss in Germany in the 1930s before he and his wife fled Hitler. Many musicians in Los Angeles at that time. And I got to play with somebody like that who knew from the horse's mouth what Tilloenspiegel should sound like and Don Juan and some of those wonderful things. So I got to sit next to my teacher and hear how it was supposed to sound right from the very first lesson practically. And when I came to New York, it was, you know, I came with my part of Beethoven's Ninth all marked up from how Richard Laird had conducted it. And he was extremely romantic and detailed, and he had an expression on every note. He had retards and accelerandos and little things that I just loved, and I had it all written in my part. And I brought the part to a lesson, I guess my second or third lesson, and Zimmerman took an eraser and started to erase, and I said, oh, please, that's my favorite Beethoven Ninth part, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to be rude, but please don't. He said, I'm erasing this because this is not right for you as a student. He said, I'm teaching you how to play this at an audition, so the 9 people on the committee and the conductor will be able to superimpose their interpretation on your skeleton of playing what's on the printed page. You can't do all these exaggerations because most conductors won't agree with this. They have their own ideas. And some cellist or violist on the committee will say that's too exaggerated, too fast, or too slow. I want you to play the printed part. And this means that the quarter note in your very first statement, the quarter note upbeat A, that's your tempo for the whole page. Well, I was astounded and I was shocked. And of course, naturally, I realized in 5 minutes that he was teaching me how to play an audition correctly. And when you're in an orchestra, you have to be the tabula rasa for the conductor. You have to be there supporting whatever the conductor tells you to do at that moment, and you have to be ready to do it. So that's what he was training me to do and anyone else who studied. You have to understand the basic skeleton is first, and after that, you can have your own ideas, and you can play it. You can show in your students. You can play it for them different ways, but you also have to explain exactly what he explain to me, which I think is right. If you do an exaggerated, crazy version that's too far away from the printed page, the answer from the personnel manager will be, thank you very much. Don't call us. We'll call you. You know, it's a joke, but it's true. You know, next. Thank you very much. After 5 minutes, if you play a very wild version of that, and you know, part of it is the problem. I find a lot of students that come to me today, they're full of a lot of crazy YouTube performances that I don't allow my students to watch. I tell them, listen to Toscanini recordings, Zell, Reiner with Chicago for Strauss, because he knew Strauss. He was a friend of Strauss and premiered many of his operas. And he knew exactly what Strauss wanted, and it shows in those performances with Chicago Symphony. And Bernstein also was very good with Strauss and with many other things. But I would say choose Zell with Cleveland and choose Toscanini with the NBC or with the Philharmonic for anything else, because those are bedrock interpretations. They're solid. They're not too fast, not too slow. They're exactly what you should learn from when you're studying how to play something the best way. Then when you get a job in an orchestra, then you have to do whatever the conductor said or whatever the principal bass wants to do. That's different. Then you're flexible. You can do that. But you've got to know the bedrock truth about the best conductors and the best performances. I don't let my students listen to the Lower Slabovia Philharmonic conducted by Joe Schmo.
Yeah.
I don't want them to see this. I don't want them to hear it. I don't want them to be influenced by, oh, I just heard the most wonderful. I said, stop. If it isn't Zell or Toscanini or Bernstein for a lot of things, too, for Mahler symphonies, Bernstein, Bruno Walter, a couple of other people, Metropolis, but I would say stick to those names and you won't go wrong. You won't go far afield. You may have a metronome of one or two details different, but you won't have the basic feeling of the piece wrong. As Hamlet says in the soliloquy, tear a passion to tatters, that finishes you at an audition, unless you got a crazy conductor who likes that. And I don't know of anybody today. I really don't. I don't think that conductors hear a player before they get through the preliminaries, and your colleagues are going to listen to the preliminaries. And I would say most of the teachers and players that I know today are pretty much like Ed Barker, Hal Robinson, Max Dimoff, people like that who are absolutely you know, they tell their students the truth, which is that you have to observe the printed page. You have to take that as your basis. And if you don't do that, you're in danger.
You know, one of my main teachers was Michael Hovnanian, who played in the Chicago Symphony.
Oh, I know him. Yes.
Yeah, great guy.
He wrote that wonderful article about the arpeggione could be in the original key. Help! It's too hard for me. But it's great. The scholarship that he shows is great, you know?
Yeah. I remember him saying that exactly what you said to me. He said
Really? He
realized when he started doing well on auditions, he just decided to play exactly what was on the page and not worry about anything else.
And amazing that he started to win, right?
Yeah. That was the moment. That was the moment that all of a sudden he started advancing, started being in the finals. And
there you go.
People have that misconception, though. They're trying to stand out in a certain way.
They tried to be individual and to attract. Listen, I had a lovely young lady come here today for a lesson with me. Don Palm is teaching her at NEC, and she's only a sophomore, and she's already so smart. But she said, can I play the second move in Bodicini 2? I said, only a sophomore and you're studying that? I thought, oh my gosh, that's so advanced. But I said, go ahead. So she played. And I said, wait a minute. I said, you know, you don't want to make an opera out of this yet. You've got a long way to go before you get to the variations in the middle of this movement. This is only basic theme. So don't do that. And don't do what Jeff Turner says in your shift. Don't give a meow. Meow. He calls it a meow, which I think is really sweet. So it's less offensive than, you know, don't do a sly that's so ugly. Instead of that, he just says, please, less meowing, which is a very charming way of correcting someone. So I said, you know, how about that? And so she snapped to right away. She realized it immediately, and she corrected. And she found out. I said, yeah, you want to do that because you want to save some of the little changes that you're going to make for later. You don't want to do it right away. And also spoil the beginning basic theme is perfectly lovely. So, you know, she was really smart. She's going to be a terrific player. She really is. She's already so smart and talented. It's great to see somebody like that, so young, too. I've heard every audition at the Philharmonic, I think, since 1974 was the first year that they allowed members of the section to take place. Before that, it was only the principal players and the assistants that were allowed to be at an audition, and the conductor, of course. But after that, we had something in the contract that allowed members of the section to take part, which is great. So I've heard every single audition, and believe me, accuracy counts. It really does. And I agree with Michael Hovnanian. Really, that's very important.
We'll get right back to our conversation with Orin, but I want to give a shout out to Upton Bass String Instrument Company and let you know about their Mittenwald bass line. And this is the sister bass to their Brescian in terms of body size and geometry. So if you drew a line from the widest points of the upper and lower bouts of a Brescian and connected that line to the corners of said bouts, you'd have the outline for the Mittenwald. So Upton kept it true to the Mittenwald school by including outer linings, Mittenwald F-holes from a great bass that they had in their showroom floor, hat peg tuners, and the like. So if you like everything about the Brescian model but the violin corners, you are a Mittenwald person for sure. Check out Upton online at UptonBass.com. And thank you so much for sponsoring the podcast, guys. All right, let's dive back into our conversation with Orin O'Brien.
What a tremendous perch to take in, just like, you know, decades of bass players coming. Who knows what that number of players that has come through and auditioned for the Philharmonic over those years.
It's got to be hundreds.
Maybe a way to phrase it, like, what makes people sit up and take notice versus next? You know, thank you very much. What's something else besides that?
Well, I mean, a very good sense of rhythm.
Yeah.
Impeccable rhythm is one thing, and impeccable intonation. If you've got that, you've got like 85% right there. You know, if you don't have that, you know, Zimmerman used to say, if you don't have excellent intonation and rhythm, nothing else counts. And he was right in saying that. Before we get into what makes a successful audition, can I just tell you, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about Zimmerman.
Oh, please.
Because,
yeah.
And also, that's why I suggested you talk to Don Palma, because he had a year with him before Zimmerman died. And that's the only reason that he called me up. and asked to study with me is because he knew that I'd studied with Zimmerman and that I also started teaching at Zimmerman's request because Zimmerman became ill for a year. In 1959, he had phlebitis and he had to keep his leg up on the couch so he couldn't stand up and teach and play. He took a year off from the Philharmonic and somebody else went to sub for him there. And it happened to be that that bass player, Jimmy Bernand, was the first bass of City Opera. So I got all his work. I did the busiest year that I ever had done at that point because Zimmerman was sick and the other people, you know, filled in, you know, sort of all in a row. We all just sort of moved up one in a way. And I started to teach then. I was paralyzed with fear. I didn't sit down for the first 5 years that I taught because I thought people would think I was being rude if I didn't stand, because Zimmerman stood when he taught too. So I thought I should stand, and I, you know, I only gave up and sat down after about 5 years. And one of the things that I remembered that Zimmerman, because I said, I have had very little experience teaching a little bit in high school, but, you know, to younger players, but teaching someone that is interested in studying with you, I wouldn't know what to say. He said, just tell him what I told you. So some of the things that I remember, when I first came to Zimmerman, I had the idea, after having studied only 3 years in Los Angeles with Kestenbaum, he was a wonderful teacher, but he showed more by example and by the way he played, and by taking me through tons and tons of etudes and music and chamber music and things like that. I did a lot of playing, but I didn't really know what I was doing very well. And he wasn't so specific and particular that Zimmerman was about every single note had to be just a certain way. And when I came to Zimmerman, I was using the bow, and of course we were all playing gut strings in those years. I was using the bow as if I felt if I practiced enough, eventually the bow would do whatever it was doing by itself. I didn't realize that I had to control the bow. I felt somehow the bow was magic, and it would somehow do some nice things if I learned how to practice enough. So at first I came and I was using too much bow on every note, and Zimmerman had two little half bows that he used to use for teaching. One was a French bow frog and the other one was a German bow, and they were about half the length of a regular bow. And he asked me to play the opening of Beethoven's Fifth Scherzo with the little half a bow. And of course, I ran out of bow in the first two notes. He said, see, he says, now use this little bow and control the amount of bow. And you'll find that when you go back to your own bow, you'll feel like you're driving a Cadillac and you'll understand how you have to use it. So if you stay in the upper third of your real bow, when you're playing that, you can play the whole thing using one third of bow, and then it'll be soft enough. Then it'll really be pianissimo, and you'll have no trouble in controlling that. So that was amazing to me. And he told me, he said, when you're using so much bow and you're letting your wrist flop around, see, I thought I should use a lot of wrist motion, which is another misconception about any bow, including cello bow. So he said, you're letting the tail wag the dog. Suddenly, the light bulb went on, and I thought, oh, I have to control the way I put the bow on the string. And then he said, you're still using too much bow. Let me mark a chalk mark. So he kept chalk by the music stand, and so do I. He put a mark in the middle of the bow. He said, now, when you're playing eighth notes, da 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 da, don't go past this mark. In fact, you can even use less. I'll just put a mark at the quarter of the bow. So he said, you're going to 42nd Street when you wanted to get off the train at 34th. Do you realize that?
Nice.
And I thought that was such a marvelous image, so I use that all the time, and I also use chalk. Violinists have 3 years of 50 different kinds of bowing, whereas bass players, you play a couple of months and you're thrown in the orchestra and have to play very difficult material with no bowing advice whatsoever. People don't think that's important when they start out. They think, oh, I got to find out where the notes are. The left hand becomes an obsession. And it's really the bow arm, Zimmerman said, that is our voice. That's 90% of it. 10% the left hand, 90% of the artistry is in the bow. And I have to say, I think it's true. If you see a wonderful, experienced, clever player like Ira, you realize how many different sounds you can make with this piece of wood with hair on it. And that's another thing. Zimmerman had no prejudice whatsoever against either German or French or for one or the other. He played both, because when John Barbaroli was the music director of the New York Philharmonic in the late 30s, after Toscanini, he was music director for 5 years, and he was a cellist. And he wanted the whole bass section to play French bow. So Fred Zimmerman switched to French bow. He taught himself how to play the French bow because he also felt that his students should also have the opportunity to play to audition for Philadelphia, which prefers the French bow for many years. They used to. They don't now, I don't think. But I think they used to for about 40, 50 years. They were pretty much all French bow. And he thought, well, that was kind of a shame if his students didn't get to audition because of the wrong bow. So he taught both. And I thought that's the right attitude to have, is that either bow is wonderful because, as he used to say, you don't play with your bow, you play with your brains. Ira and I have talked about this endlessly, and we sort of laugh about it because so many people have, you know, they have the old prejudice from 100 years ago. My teacher told me when I came to New York, the Franco-Prussian War is going on still, or the Hundred Years' War between France and Germany. It's still going on as far as bows are concerned. Don't be surprised if somebody scorns you because you play the German bow. So, you know, fortunately, I haven't experienced much of that, but and certainly it's an indication of stupidity. If you hear anything like that now, it's that the person doesn't know anything. They don't have an experience. But at the time, you know, 60 years ago, it still was a bit of a thing. And I was shocked to hear that Zimmerman changed to French bow because the conductor didn't want to see anybody with German bow in the section. So that was kind of a shock to me. But that's already from the 1930s, so that's ancient history. And I'm glad it's not now.
What a revolutionary teacher, and just an amazing, and I mean, like, what a fantastic experience it must have been to study with him. I mean, I feel like I've had contemporary concept of bowing technique on my music stand since I was a teenager. You know, I still use it.
People look at it. As a matter of fact, one famous colleague, who I won't mention his name because he's not alive anymore, he looked at it when it came out. He said, "What's so hard about this? It's only two notes." So, you know, I had a good laugh over that because basically it wasn't printed when I studied with Zimmerman. He hadn't written it yet, but he had notes. He had a notebook with a lot of examples from the orchestral literature, particularly with the bowing pattern written on one line and above it the actual notes of the passage. And he would make the bowing symbol the open strings or the A and the E, and he thought that was a great way to understand the way the bow works before you start worrying about fingerings. And when he said, "Would you please, here's one pattern like da 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 da, would you do 8 variations of that, please?" And because I had, by then, I had a copy of stamp, and that's the way I made a little extra money, by copying things for people, because that was before the age of Xerox. You know, that was the cave days. We were living in caves then. You know? And we were copying. I had ink, and I had a special pen that the nib spread slightly for the larger notes and so on. And I used to do, I had very good copy handwriting, musical handwriting. So Zimmerman said, "Here, take this and make me a page with 8 variations." And then he would give me 6/8, the patterns in 6/8. "Now do that and do this for 6/8. And now do this pattern, do that." So I basically hand copied that whole book. And he took my copies, especially of the permutations, that stuff, which is complicated to keep your eye from crossing, you know, while you're copying it. And I did a lot of that stuff, and he ended up taking that to the publisher and making the book out of that. Because at that time, I don't think there were music programs on computers yet. There weren't computers yet in 1966, I don't believe. I think computers came in the 80s and 90s. I don't think that was before that. There wasn't it wasn't anything like Finale or Sibelius to do music copying on, like what Douglas Mapp does so well, you know. So he had me do that by hand. And so by the time I had done all those exercises, and actually I practiced them, I took them home, I wrote them, I practiced them, I brought them back the next lesson. And to me, it was a revelation because it made things like that were always so difficult for me. The last movement of Mozart 40th, all that stuff, I couldn't manage the two slurred and two separate. I thought the two separate had to be off the string. That was one of my first stupid misconceptions, because I saw dots over the notes and I thought, "Oh, it has to be da, up, up, da, up, up." And Zimmerman said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I thought I saw the dots." He said, "Don't you realize that when the dots are in the part, that's only the editor's way of saying not slurred. It doesn't have to be staccato. You have to understand, even violinists don't play that off the string." I said, "Oh, you can play it on the string?" "Yes," he said, "and keep your bow on the string. Use 2 inches of bow, maybe 1 inch would even be better if it's a faster tempo, and just go da 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 like the bowing pattern." Oh my God, I suddenly could play it. I couldn't play it before. And suddenly that understanding of basic violin bowing technique made it possible for me to play like a musician instead of like an idiot, you know? So to me, this book was unbelievable, a revelation. And how to practice it is to make sure you stay on the string legato detaché if you're practicing for something fast. And if you're practicing spiccato, start spiccato at 92 to the half note and go until you get to 132 and then go back on the string. You're not required to do off the string past 132. You're not required. That's not a requirement that they can force you to do. Only certain people can do past 132, and that's sauté then. It's a very soft volume. It's not a loud volume. And if you want louder, then you go on the string. There's certain formulas that you need to know as a professional string player that a lot of people are not taught. And that's what I found the Zimmerman book was so essential to help you with, that gave you formulas to be able to play any passage. And that's what every violinist has. They know this from age 6, and we don't get this most of the time. So that's one thing I was so grateful for. And when I started teaching, also, I started listening to the lessons that he gave other players because I was trying to pay him back for what he taught me for free for a couple of summers. He said, no, I don't want you to go anymore to a festival or anything. I never went to another festival after I did the Music Academy for 4 summers. He said, I feel that you lose too much in a summer. He said, I'll teach you if you'll do some copying for me and everything. So I tried to organize his music library. And at the same time, while I was writing down in longhand and then taking it home and typing it on cards, I sat in his teaching room, which is a living room, and listened to him teach. So I got a good education on his approach to everyone, which, by the way, was to the individual. He used to say, if someone comes in with a broken leg, you don't give them a Band-Aid and an aspirin. You try to set their leg and, you know, give them 6 weeks of, you know, in a cast. You don't treat someone for something that they don't need, or you don't not fix something that they badly need so they can go ahead and do something else. You must fix something that's wrong before you can do anything else. You can't teach repertoire if they can't handle the bow with a good way of being able to understand what the music means and how to execute it. And you have to have some direction for this. You can't learn it on your own, mostly. That's why people study the violin for 10 years, is because you can't learn something like that really well on your own. You have to have some guidance. So that's what I thought was so marvelous of him. He taught to the individual. He didn't hand the same stack of music to everybody, with the exception of the bowing technique, that had certain basic exercises and certain etudes. He was a big fan of etudes, and so am I. And believe it or not, I've had a few pupils, very few, that didn't like etudes. And I said, okay, well, we'll make whatever piece you're studying, we'll make that into sort of an etude. But I really think that etudes are great because they give you a chance to do something in a pattern and get very good at it. And you know, if you do the Storcherabi 57, or I don't teach the Billet method, but I know some of those etudes are wonderful. They're very musical. A lot of people love them. And I like the Findeisen etudes are incredibly difficult. And one of the summers that I studied with Zimmerman, he was editing the 25 Findeisen etudes for international. And he asked me, he said, will you come and write down the fingerings and bowings while I play through? So he stood there in his living room and played through the Findeisen etudes while I wrote down the fingerings and bowings. And I saw him play them all. So, you know, they are playable, but they're the most difficult etudes that I know, I must say. And I can't play all of them. I've studied a few of them, but I didn't have the time to study all of them. I should, I'm embarrassed to say, but they're really worthwhile. And the gratis, too. I know Don Palm is a big fan of the gratis on Parnassum of Simandl, because they give you a chance to repeat certain patterns until they're ingrained into your fingers and arm. So I'm a fan. You know, naturally, people today, they start taking auditions at, you know, age 19, 20, 21, and they want to be prepared for that. But it does help to have a background in all the basic things that we need as a player. And most violins have it starting at age 3 or 4. We have to wait till we're older and tall enough and strong enough to hold down a bass string, you know. And also, by the way, up until 1960-61, most players played on gut strings.
What was that whole transition? Because, I mean, talk about a total revolution in probably the way people
yes.
are taught and even string height and all that. What was the progression of that?
I'll tell you exactly, and I'm glad you asked, because Chris Mathers wrote me that one of your fans asked, what was it like with the Gunther Schuller Quartet?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, I'd be very happy to talk about that, because that was one of the musical experiences of my life that I will never forget, working with the composer Gunther Schuller and with my three beloved colleagues who are all gone, but I will always remember because of their kindness to me and because of what they showed me about playing and about what we did together, and for Gunther too. So Bob Gladstone was one of Zimmerman's pupils that was first, I think, in the New Orleans Symphony, then in Pittsburgh, then he was in New York City Ballet, and then he got in the New York Philharmonic. That's the way it used to be. It used to be that you had to be in the junior leagues, like a baseball player, you know, and then in order to get into the big leagues, you had to have plenty of experience. So Bob won the Philharmonic in 1956, and he recommended me for the New York City Ballet, which was wonderful because conductor knew me because it was Barzan, and he knew me from having played in the National, and he tried me out for a week with a couple other players, and he picked me. So it was just great, and I got a job my last year at Juilliard. It wasn't a long job. It was only 10 weeks the first year, but it turned out into a wonderful job, and the players there were fantastic, and I learned a lot from them. So came around 1959, Bob Gladstone was in the Philharmonic with Fred Zimmermann. Fred Zimmermann was assistant principal for many years, and they were in the Philharmonic, and I got a call one day from Bob Gladstone. He said, I am doing Gunther Schuller a favor. He asked me, could I get together a group to play his double bass quartet, because he wrote it in 1948, and he took it to Oscar Zimmermann, and Oscar Zimmermann said, this is unplayable. It's so hard, nobody could play it. I'm sorry, can't do it. So he asked Bob, he said, do you think you could find people that could play this? Because I'd really like to hear it. And Bob said, you bet. I know players that can play this. So Bob called me, and he called Alvin Brim, who was another dear friend of mine and of his. He was a composer and a freelancer around New York, and also a Zimmerman pupil. And Fred, he asked Fred to play. And Gunther called me up and said, well, you know, he said, I have the parts. He said, I have handwritten parts, but I've lost the score. I hear you have a copying stamp. Would you copy a score for me if I give you the four parts? So I said, sure. So he gave me the parts, and I spent about a month copying out a score for him, which I still have a copy of. I copied on onion skin so he could reproduce it. And we all practiced and played from the score so we could see what everybody else was doing, you know. So we read through it after we practiced our own parts, and we read through it with Gunther one Sunday morning, because Sunday morning was the only time of the week that we all four of us were free, because at that time Philharmonic had concerts on Sunday afternoon. And I had ballet performances Sunday afternoon, Sunday night, and so on. That was the only time we could all get together. And Gunther conducted us, and we were astounded at the sound. And in those years, Fred and I were still playing gut strings, and Bob and Alvin, however, were in the forefront of putting steel on. Bob had put steel on in the mid-50s when Vienna strings, the Tamastic strings, began to be made really well, and he put them on. Well, I didn't like the sound of them under my ear. They sounded guitar-y to me. So I stuck with the gut strings, I think just because I wasn't willing to give them a chance. So we rehearsed for a couple of months, Sunday mornings. We did about 7 or 8 rehearsals and got it pretty good. And Gunther, the last rehearsal before he hired a recording studio in July of 1959, and he said, you know, Fred and Orin, you know, your strings really don't hold the pitches of the harmonics, especially the double-stopped harmonics. They go down in pitch. The other guys there, their strings hold the pitch better. Would you mind switching to steel string for the recording tomorrow?
Oh, wow.
And we didn't realize you need a different lower bridge setup. You need the strings broken in.
Yeah.
For a few days, because otherwise they sound tinny. And we didn't realize that if you put that on with the gut level bridge, they'd be too high. Well, we just put the string, we ran out and bought the steel string, put them on, and the next day, the recording session, we had a session for 3 hours. I thought I was going to bleed to death. I thought my fingers were going to be cut in half. I was sure that my fingers were going to bleed at the end. They weren't, but they were very sore because the strings were too high. And also it's a different bowing technique, which I didn't realize until I let them stay on and went home and tried to practice. So we finished the recording, and I couldn't get over that Fred... He also played an encore on that recording, which is not on the commercial. He played an arrangement of the Bach 6 cello suite Saraband, which Gunther had arranged for four basses, and Fred played the top line, and it was just breathtakingly beautiful. And I couldn't realize, how could he do that with the strings so high? But he did. You know, we were all sort of trying our best and everything, and Gunther was very pleased with the way it worked out, and he published it. He made a recording of it, and he made an LP of it, which he printed with his record company in Boston. Mm-hmm. And the next day I went home and I ripped off my steel strings, put the gut back on and went to work at the ballet. And then the next year, Gunther said, I'd like to give a concert in Carnegie Recital Hall. Three other composers and myself want to give an all composers concert, and I want the bass quartet. So we rehearsed for another couple of weeks, and because we knew it already, it was easier to put together, and we got up and we played it. Of course, Gunther was conducting. Nowadays, kids play it without a conductor. Right. Kids in school play it without a conductor, which just blows me away. I bet they're so talented, and they know it, and they love it, and they enjoy working on it. I coached it last year at Manhattan School with four bass players, two of whom were freshmen. I couldn't get over it. It was a great experience. So anyway, So time goes on, and we play this in the Carnegie Recital Hall. We get a wonderful review where it says it's like sounds like Bartok and Stravinsky, and was wonderful and virtuoso, and never knew the basses could sound that way. By then, I had put steel strings back on because my two colleagues in the ballet, Ted Flowerman and David Walter, had by then changed to steel strings. And when we played it at the Carnegie Recital Hall, most of the bass players in New York were there, and they all saw and heard what steel strings could do. So those that didn't already have them, which were very few, switched that year, and also that's when Fred began to teach on steel. He left the strings on after we made the recording. He kept his steel strings on because he told me later, he said, you know why I'm going to keep them on? Because it takes 6 months to teach a new student how to play a clear, pure tone on gut strings. It takes 6 months to get people to have that kind of finesse. And with steel, it takes 5 minutes. He said, there's no comparison to the ease of playing. No comparison. And then by then, we also realized in 1960 or 61, two bass players invented the bridge adjusters, so you could have a bridge that could go up and down. Jesse Tycho and George Andre. George was the first bass of the Met, and Jesse Tycho was a freelance bass player who later on played in the Met. And the two of them had gotten a guy together to, craft this first experimental bridge adjusters, and everybody ran out and bought them, and they made a huge difference because when the weather got hot, you know what I did in the ballet for 5 years? My stand partner, Teddy Flowerman, was so kind to me. He used to cut little pieces of a cigar box top and put them underneath my bridge feet to raise the bridge in winter when the bridge sank low because the wood shrank. And then in summer, he'd take out the pieces. And he always did it for me, so I didn't have to know how to do it because I wasn't very good mechanically. And he had figured it out. He did it on his bass. He said, I'll do it on your bass. So but then the adjustable bridges took care of that. If you were out of doors and playing in a very hot, humid weather, you could lower the bridge. It's made a huge difference to bass players. So those little things, you can't picture how horrible it was to play an out-of-door concert on gut strings with no movable bridge. Oh, you can't imagine the torture. Imagine having to play Mahler First on gut strings in the parks with a 95-degree temperature and 100% humidity. We used to joke, oh, it's good weather for a bass recital. We used to joke, this is perfect weather for a bass recital. Because everybody, Zimmerman used to say, you're all brothers and sisters together. If you're bass players, you should treat each other like brothers and sisters, because it's so hard to play the bass. Everybody should understand we all suffer so terribly. You should band together and be friends. So I think that's the right attitude to have. And I think your blog and your podcast kind of prove that all bass players want to help each other. They always want to find out what's a better way.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, there's something special. There's something special about the bass community, isn't there?
Yes, I agree with you. I feel so lucky with my life. And people were so good to me at the beginning of my career, in the middle, and now. I mean, it's the same thing. It's everybody, there's a bass community there, and everybody is appreciative of when you show a little kindness, it comes back to you in every possible way. It really, I have found that to be true. And I've had some wonderful experiences with fellow players, with the people that influenced me. Imagine being surrounded by two bass players like Teddy Flowerman on one side and David Walter on the other. I just learned. All I had to do was just do what they did, and that was right. And it was like perfect. Whenever we had to play the Young Person's Guide, we would practice the middle section together for intonation. The rest was easy. We could just practice dum ba dum bum bum, make sure it was in tune. Or certain things in the Prokofiev Prodigal Son, slow movement has a couple of bass solis in it that go very high. On Gut Strings, it wasn't so easy. And we did the premiere of Aegon, the Stravinsky 12-tone ballet, with Gut Strings. We played all those awful harmonica. We just thought we would kill ourselves the first rehearsal. We thought, he can't be serious he wrote this, you know, because it was really hard. We used to have to try to frantically tune quickly before that to make sure that our strings didn't go down in pitch during the first couple of movements, you know. I mean, it just, that kind of challenge, and that we did it, and we were happy about it, and we were kind of enjoying the playing together. It was just lovely. And I had 10 years of that. Before I joined the Philharmonic, I had 10 years of sort of a perfect feeling on the job with two great players that were kind to me because I was the young twerp that didn't know anything, and they helped me.
We'll get into the third and final part of our interview with Orin in just a second, but I want to give a shout out to our other sponsor, the Bass Violin Shop, which offers professional setups, repairs, and restorations at reasonable prices. And they go beyond their customers' expectations with meticulously set up basses, friendly and helpful staff, and highly skilled luthiers. So whatever your playing needs, the Bass Violin Shop will work hard to get the most out of your instrument without blowing your budget. Check them out at bassviolinshop.com. Okay, here's the third part of our interview with Orin O'Brien.
Obviously, you've talked a lot about joining the Philharmonic and that sort of thing, but I, you know, obviously a bunch of people asked me to ask you about the experience of being, you know, the first woman in the orchestra outside of from the harpist that they would hire. And you know, you shared a story that I just got such a kick out of.
Oh, which one was that?
It was the one with the wardrobe cases. And like,
Walter Botti. Who's the father of our second oboe player in the orchestra. Rob Botti's our second oboe. That was his dad. And Walter, who, you know, everybody thought he was kind of, you know, and he was so kind and so sweet and thoughtful. My first month on tour, he said, just close your eyes and I'll guide you through the backstage melee of everybody changing their clothes in front of their trunk. And then I'll get you to your trunk and you take out your clothes and I'll guide you back. You just keep your eyes shut. It was so thoughtful, you know. And actually, I'll tell you something. It was easy for me to make the adjustment because I knew most of the people in the orchestra. Most of the men, half of them at least, I had memorized their names when I was an usher at Carnegie Hall. When I was a student at Juilliard, my first 2 years at Juilliard, I ushered 10 shows a week at Carnegie Hall. That was part of the job. You had to usher 10 shows every concert. And there were 4 or 5 concerts a week of the Philharmonic. So I got to know everybody by sight. You know, I would say hello to them in the street. Oh, hello, Mr. So-and-so. Hello, Mr. So-and-so. I knew them because they were like heroes of all of us. Any musician that ushered there knew the music, you know, especially those of us that studied with people in the orchestra. We worshiped those people. And they were our heroes. And we looked up to them. We looked forward when someone was going to have a little solo. And Bob Brennan was the first bass then, and he was still playing Gut Strings when I joined the orchestra. He played Gut Strings, I think, to the end of his life in the orchestra. And he used to ask me, does the mute first sound better with the mute or without? Why don't you go in the back of the hall and listen? You know, when we'd be putting the programs together at the front of the stage before the audience came in. And he would say, why don't you go? And he would make me feel like I had something to offer as an opinion, that he asked my opinion, what did the Mahlers sound like? So, you know, I felt connected with the orchestra from being a student and from studying with somebody in the orchestra. And, you know, also listening to the broadcast. When I was a kid in Los Angeles, I used to listen to the Sunday broadcast of the Philharmonic. Saturday afternoon, the Met, and Sunday afternoon, the Philharmonic. So, you know, I felt sort of steeped in their history and in the respect for the orchestra and for the men in the orchestra. Also, the second bassoon in the ballet was Harold Goltzer, who became the assistant principal bassoon in the Philharmonic before I joined. He joined Philharmonic in 1959. I joined in 66. So he was somebody I knew. I knew the second trumpet. Carmen Fornarato was in the New York City Ballet. Ed Irwin was the associate principal trombone. He was in the New York City Ballet, and he went into the Philharmonic. I knew a few musicians I knew by sight, because at the end of every concert in Carnegie, the ushers downstairs have to march up to the edge of the stage and stand there to prevent the audience from going on the stage. There's steps at the side of each side of the stage, and we would have to stand there to prevent, in case an audience member wanted to rush on stage, you know, maybe to hug one of their favorite musicians or the conductor, and we were there to prevent that. So I knew them all by sight, and I knew their names, so I could be respectful. You know, I used to call them Mr. So-and-so when I joined, because I thought that, you know, I was a young member and I should show respect. So, you know, and then they would all say, no, call me by my first name. So, you know, people, they were by and large very nice and very welcoming. So it wasn't strange, because I knew so many of them. I had freelanced with the concertmaster. David Nadian became a concertmaster the same month that I joined the orchestra. Bernstein had just chosen him as the new concertmaster. I had done Baroque recordings with him, one bass, one cello stuff, Baroque stuff with him for years before. So I kind of knew a lot of them as musicians, and they knew that I wasn't some kid just out of school. I already had 10 years experience, you know. So it wasn't difficult, because I showed my respect and my sensitivity by, you know, like, for instance, they gave me the outside locker, the one that was closest to the door, so I could open my locker door and wouldn't have to see the guys dressing in the bass room, mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there was a kind of a mutual consideration and respect, which I think is common in any group that works together. And that's the way it was in the ballet, which was very much mixed, men and women. It was not just one or the other. There were a lot of women in the ballet orchestra, including the concertmaster. By the time I left, the concertmaster was a very well-known violinist, Marilyn Wright, who was outstanding. And so, you know, it was not a strange feeling for me, because I had already worked in New York for 10 years. I subbed at the Met for 5 years. Leinsdorf hired me as extra bass, as seventh bass for the ring cycle. So I started to work there, and then I began to be used as a sub when somebody was sick. They would call me to come in and play an opera, which was a thrilling experience, because the conductors then were so fantastic. And I even played Falstaff with Bernstein in 1964 at the Met, which was so exciting. Oh, man. I mean, I'm so lucky. The experiences I had even before I joined the Philharmonic kind of prepared me how to be in the Philharmonic, you know, that I didn't feel out of place, because I already had lots and lots of experience. I already knew most of the repertoire. I remember my first year, out of the 104 pieces that we had in that season, I only didn't know four of them.
That's amazing.
So,
wow.
I already had so much experience,
yeah.
You know, before I even came to New York. I had already had 2 years in Pasadena, and a lot of, you know, I played in any orchestra that needed a bass player. The whole time I was at college, I had 1 year at UCLA. I played with Lucas Foss in the UCLA Symphony. I played with Jan Popper in the Opera Orchestra. I played in the Santa Monica Symphony with a brother conducting, the brother of Michel Piastro, who was the Philharmonic concertmaster in the 1930s. He was a conductor of that little orchestra. I played in any orchestra that needed a bass. So I had a lot of experience even before I came to New York, and I was very grateful for all the stuff that I knew. When I got in the Philharmonic, I felt, oh, yeah, I can play that. Yeah, I know that. I know how that goes. People, you know, they don't realize the context that they need to know. They can't just know the bass part. That's really not well prepared. You've got to know the whole piece. You know, that's another thing that a lot of young students don't understand, that the more they can listen to recordings or go to live performances of their local symphony orchestra and look at the bass section and see how things are done, That is very instructive. A lot of people forget about that. That's a great way to learn.
Yeah, I see that so much. You know, I did a little informal survey just looking at people that have gone on and landed bigger orchestra jobs, that sort of thing, and people that hadn't. And one of the things that kept coming up is people just going and seeing live concerts. Like the people that did that had success.
Yes.
I always thought that was so interesting.
It's true. You're absolutely right. And nobody talks about that, really. Well, teachers do. Certainly, all the teachers I know do. Because, as a matter of fact, those of us on the Manhattan faculty and Manus that play at the Met and play at the Philharmonic, we make sure that our kids get comps. And I just taught this young lady today from Boston. She goes every week to the Boston Symphony. Her teachers get her into rehearsals or to a complimentary ticket or something. That's so important because you're seeing the context of what you're studying. And that if somebody's really fascinated and wants to learn, that is a really good way to learn, really. And then you pin your teacher down at the lesson and say, I noticed this and that. And that's different from what I saw last week. When you did it last year with this conductor, he did something different. Well, why is that? You know, when you absorb all of that, then you're really ready to take your place amongst all those wonderful trained people, you know, because it is a train. It's a tremendous training. You know, it's like Meistersinger being an apprentice.
Mm-hmm, totally.
You know, first you learn the beginning of this and you're allowed to sing in the chorus and then you're allowed to have a little small part and then you get a secondary part and oh, you know, 20 years later you get to sing the lead in Aida or something. But, you know, it's very much like that when you're a conductor too. If you start off coaching the chorus and doing piano rehearsals with the soloists and then you're allowed to conduct maybe one rehearsal, meanwhile the head conductor supervises you. I don't know if conductors get that kind of wonderful experience anymore. The Europeans did. They all started out in opera, which prepares you for symphony.
You were in the Philharmonic with Homer Mensch, right? Weren't you
right.
Stand
he was
partners?
My stand partner
yeah.
My first few years, yes. Oh, I used to freelance with Homer, too. We used to do all kinds of jobs at Columbia University, playing with Vladimir Usachevsky and Otto Luning, the two loony composers there at Columbia. You know, stuff with the recorded tape stuff while the orchestra played something else. We did all kinds of jobs together. Before I joined the film, we played in parking lots with Julius Grossman conducting trust fund concerts. You know, Local 802 has a trust fund where they fund special concerts, you know, free concerts for the public. So we used to do stuff in the summer in the parking lot in Queens playing the Mendelssohn Fourth with Julius Grossman. Yeah, we used to do really, really awful stuff, you know. So when we got in the Philharmonic, gee, it's air-conditioned. It's nice. Oh, yeah. Oh, you can't believe some of the stuff that freelancers have to do. So, Homer was a wonderful professional, We always used to joke about Homer. He always looked like he was always impeccably dressed mm-hmm. and groomed, and he carried a briefcase. We always felt that he had a complete change of clothes and a new bass in the briefcase. That's always the way he was. He was impeccable. He was like the perfect professional.
Wow.
So he was wonderful to play with, just wonderful.
And you know, like someone sitting here in 2017 looking back, they'd be surprised that someone like Homer would leave the Philharmonic and go play jingles and sessions, right?
Let me explain you why. Let me explain exactly. Do you know that he was my teacher, Milton Kestenbaum's stand partner in Pittsburgh with Fritz Reiner in the late 1930s? My teacher, Milton Kestenbaum's first job was in Washington, D.C. with the National. And then from there, he went to Pittsburgh as principal bass for Reiner, and Homer was his stand partner. And then in 1939, or I think around then, Homer got in the New York Philharmonic. His teacher, Anselm Fortier, was the first bass in the Philharmonic. Now, Fortier, I believe, was French-Canadian, and he had studied in Paris with Nani, Edward Nani. So there's the French connection with that beautiful French conservatory approach, and that was like the Prague school of playing, and then the Nani French school of playing, two very very distinct and wonderful schools of playing, and I think that Fortier and Homer represented that school. So Homer joined the Philharmonic, I think 39 or 40, something like that, and then left in 1948 because he got the CBS orchestra job. Now, let me point out something that nobody knows these days or thinks about. in those days, NBC had the Toscanini Orchestra, which also played all the other shows on NBC during the week. Toscanini didn't know that. He thought the orchestra was only for him, but they were playing all the commercial things, the Helen Hayes Hour and all that stuff. They were all doing that. So the NBC and ABC, each of those networks had their own orchestra. And Homer got the CBS orchestra, by the way. And that job paid 52 paychecks a year, approximately $7,500 a year in those years. Philharmonic was paying 30 weeks a year. Maybe you got invited to do Lewis's Stadium, the summer stadium concert, but maybe not. It wasn't the full orchestra. If you were a principal player, you got invited, but sometimes you didn't. So it was not a sure income. So if you had 30 weeks, it was about $3,500. The year that I joined, that I came to New York, 1954, NBC was making $7,500 a year, and the Philharmonic was making $3,500. Now that's double income if you are an NBC, ABC, or CBS. So Homer left to make a better living. And he did a lot of commercial recordings. He did movie scores. He did toothpaste commercials, whatever, you know, you did. In fact, there was a little guy named Ernesto that used to be a bass caddy. He used to run from job to job with the bass as so the bass player wouldn't have to tire themselves out carrying the bass. And wow. Homer would have this little Ernesto running behind him carrying his bass.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, really.
What
and
an
before
image.
The wheel was invented. Yeah. So that's why Homer, and then when the freelance stuff started to dry up in 1966, Homer came back in the Philharmonic the same time that I joined. That was the new, as of August 1st, 1966, the new bass section was Bob Bernand, John Schaefer, Walter Botti, Homer Mensch, me, Jimmy Candido, Benny Schlossberg, and Mario Polisi. That was the lineup. Oh, and I forgot, the second stand was Walter and Carlo Raviola. I promise you, there was a bass player with the name of Raviola. It was true. He was Italian, and he was in the orchestra for 1 year before he retired. He retired the year after I joined. But I had the pleasure of knowing Carlo, and he retired back to Italy when he left. He was quite a character and a very, very good player, too. I was sitting with Homer, and that was my first couple of years in the orchestra was with Homer.
You know, there was something that, and it was something you mentioned on that panel discussion, and it was something that a couple of listeners also wanted me to dig into with you, and that's like the nuances of being a principal of a section in an orchestra.
Really?
Yeah, and I just think that's interesting to think about, like a couple things you mentioned about is like there were musical skills and social skills that you need for that job.
Oh, yeah. Well, I would imagine on any job, but particularly in music where in any section, well, I would say the string sections particularly, everybody in the section probably inside secretly thinks they can do a better job or as good as whoever is principal. That's a given. You know, everybody feels, oh, I know how to do that. And then actually when you get stuck in that chair and you realize this heart-stopping moment, it's not so easy. So you have to play perfectly, really, and you have to understand what the conductor wants and be able to play it his way. At the same time, playing the way that you know is customary, is traditional, that everyone will understand that's the correct way. And yet you also have to, I would say, one of the keys of being a terrific principal is keeping the mood light in your section, keeping everybody feeling that you appreciate them. And I have to say that somebody who says that was great at the end of a concert is very much appreciated by a section. I think that's one thing that, you know, or if you go to a section member after the concert, maybe backstage in the bass room, everybody's, you know, changing and getting ready to go home. And the principal says, you know, that was really great tonight, fellas. You know, that was really tremendous. I thought we did beautifully. So, you know, that means something. And it doesn't cost anything to do that, but it gives a little sort of a sprinkle of compliments to everybody, makes everybody feel appreciated. And that's what you need. You need for the troops to feel appreciated because it is a group effort. It is not one person playing and everybody else faking, you know. It's not that. It's that everybody has to listen together and play what you know goes well with the group and what will support the rest of the orchestra. And to have somebody there that knows their job and also is psychologically astute is a great idea, a great thing. And some people can do it, and other people are just thinking about playing, and then they also may have hang-ups psychologically that happen sometimes because of their childhood or other experiences they've had, and they bring that to the job, and then the job becomes awkward and unpleasant and hard to people don't enjoy coming to work. You know, the ideal situation is if you enjoy coming to work and you enjoy the companionship of your section. That's fun. We try to have a bass dinner when we're on tour. We try to have a bass dinner. We've done it in China the last couple of trips that we've been there, and it's very nice. You know, it makes for social bonding. And actually, we have a coffee machine in our bass room, which one of our friends, the first bass of New York City Ballet, Ron Wasserman, gave us a coffee, one of those Nescafe thing where you put in the little pod. He gave us that several years ago when he used to sub with us a lot. And we sort of call it the Wasserman Memorial Coffee Machine. And we think of him every time we have coffee. And that's something, you know, one of the guys goes and buys all these pods. He takes orders and says, what would you like? And that's sort of like a ritual. And even though I only drink one cup of coffee at home, otherwise I wouldn't sleep all night if I had coffee afternoon. But the guys do the coffee thing, and I inhale the smell of the coffee, and it's just beautiful. No, it's really nice. Yeah. And once in a while, somebody will make something and bring it. You know, I mean, it's kind of a nice sharing feeling. It really makes any job a better job if the principal and the other players know how to integrate and how to spread a little balm on the difficulties of everybody's life. Because no matter what, nobody has a perfect life. Nobody has a life where everything goes smoothly and everything is great. Everybody has something that is not great, and that you come to the job and you try to keep your feelings of negativity away from that. But sometimes people need cheering up because things are not going so well, or they're not feeling well, and it's really wonderful if you have a group that gets along and that the principal can support that. It's really great. Because it is a tremendous thing if a principal is sensitive to the feelings of people and not just treating you like you're the army and he's the captain. It smooths the difficult things. I'll tell you, when there's a difficult conductor, you bond together in the bass room, you close the door, and everybody can go, make jokes and tell silly stories and, you know, vent their feelings and in a feeling of safety.
Yeah.
That nobody's going to rat you out, you know. So it's very important, and it's something that builds a very good feeling. I have to tell you something that I'm really proud of, not for myself, but for my section. We got a rave review on tour. We were on tour in Europe this March and April, and we were in London for a couple of days. In fact, that's where I saw Chris Mathers and his wife. And we played, I can't remember the hall, it might have been Royal Festival Hall, might have been the other one, but we got a review. We were playing Symphonie Fantastique, which, as you know, has a tricky bass part in several places. You can mess things up really beautifully for the conductor if you want to. And the conductor, if he doesn't leave you alone, if he tries to overmanage, it can also be bad. But this was great. And we got a review in one of the London papers. The critic actually got what we were doing, which is kind of rare. Most critics don't hear below middle C. You know, they don't pay attention to the bass part that much. So we got a review that said, "The Magnificent Eight of the New York Philharmonic Bass Section," which I have to explain were nine, but one of our guys was sick in the hotel. So we only had eight that night. So he said, "The Magnificent Eight basses of the New York Philharmonic played with double the volume, but always with perfect clarity." That was the review. And we thought, ah, somebody got it, that we play big, but we also play clean.
Yeah.
So we were walking around, you know, with our chest puffed out for the rest of the tour. And I said we ought to have T-shirts made up so there'll be no doubt in any conductor's mind when they face us that they're dealing with people who know what to do.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They don't have to worry about telling us how to play. In fact, the orchestra, one of the things I always loved about being a musician was the funny stories about funny things that happened, or, you know, from a previous year or a previous conductor. And I always loved the old guys in the Philharmonic used to say, when I joined, they used to say things like, You know, we tell a conductor, leave the driving to us. When you get on a bus and you want to go to Pittsburgh, you don't tell the bus driver, here, take this street and go left here and go right. He said, just tell us what you want and we'll do it. Don't tell us how to drive the bus. Okay? So I kind of like that. You know, well any orchestra has its own style and has its own kind of traditions handed on of how to play certain things. And if a conductor will be smart, they will let the orchestra play their best and not interfere with it too much. The older musicians had such wonderful ways of expressing themselves. The English horn player, when I joined the orchestra, was a man who'd been in the orchestra since 1929. His name was Engelbert Brenner, and he was wonderful musician. He had joined as second oboe, and then when Bernstein heard him play English horn, he asked him to switch to English horn, which he did after one of the players retired on English horn. So Bert took over, and he played beautifully. And he once told me, I never played a perfect concert. And I was shocked. I said, Bert, how can that be? I heard you play everything, all those solos you play, the Swan of Tuonela and the Symphony Fantastique and the Slow Mo. Oh, it's so beautiful. He says, no, but you don't understand. I'm not talking about notes. He says, I'm talking about my vision of how to play. Maybe I didn't do a dynamic particularly the way I planned. Maybe I didn't phrase something the exact way, or I didn't have the kind of sound that I had planned. It's the things that probably people wouldn't notice unless they listened to me play the same thing several different ways. He said, but I have to please myself. And he said, I don't think I ever played in my own mind a perfect concert. And I was so moved by that. Because I thought, oh my gosh, I better start listening. I better start being very, very careful, you know, because, you know, about lengths of notes, like if you play a half note, don't let it leak into the next rest, because you may be disturbing the harmony of that person that comes in there. You know, don't let your tone waft on forever if there's something else going on. Pay attention. So, you know, part of it is, part of the fun of playing in an orchestra is paying attention to everything else that goes on. There's a lot going on that sometimes you don't hear everything. You know, sometimes you aren't aware of things that you need to be aware of, like when you're with the bass clarinet, which is on the other side of the stage, you know, and things like that, little things like timing a pizzicato with the harp who's on the other side of the stage, or the timpani who's on the other side of the stage. We used to have a timpanist, now he's been gone for many years. His name was Roland Koloff, and he studied with Saul Goodman, who was the timpanist when I joined the orchestra, the great Goodman that taught everybody and invented the pedal timpani and so on. And Roland used to look at the bass section to play notes like in the Tchaikovsky fourth, when there'd be little things with the bass section staying quiet for 10 measures, and the timpani would just have bum, bum, boom, boom. And then we would come in and start to join him. And he would look at us when we joined him as if he was trying to be with us, which he was. You know, in other words, there was a kind of a mutuality there, an understanding that we're playing the same part and we should have the same quality of sound and be exactly together. Things like that that go on without any conductor saying anything, but that you're aware of all the time. Just then that happens in every page, almost in every bar of every piece, that people in the orchestra are doing chamber music on a huge, large scale that the audience has no idea about, except the sophisticated listeners and maybe the bass players that are listening. They would be aware of all these things that have to be together with other things. You know, it's really extremely complex, but that's what makes it fun.
Yeah. There's something about being in that, if whether it's timpani or the bass, there's something about seeing and experiencing the orchestra kind of from that periphery, but taking in the whole thing.
Yes.
You know, versus like being in the middle of the first or second violins, like caught up in that. I just feel like we sort of see structures and things that maybe others, they're caught up in.
I think so.
Yeah.
And also we have a little more time. We don't have the kind of complicated first violin parts that we're playing solo melodies all the time. We actually have the leisure to enjoy the harmony, you know, which to me, that's what makes me a happy player, is the harmony and the rhythm, is that we contribute so much, like in a Mahler symphony, one pizzicato, or the Beethoven slow movement of the third symphony. That can be so that can be heart-stopping if the conductor's not good. You know, that could, and then the bass section has to take over. We have to do it ourselves. which a good section will do. You know, we'll make it work. Make it work. It's going to be good no matter what happens. We'll take care of it. Don't worry. Just sit tight. We'll take you where you want to go. That's really, you know, when a section plays together well for a number of years, that is the feeling. The feeling is that we'll take care of it. Mm-hmm. That's okay. You don't have to exhaust yourself. Just, you know, we'll be okay. Just give us a nod once in a while and let us do our job. Yeah. And it's a good feeling.
Orin, I am just, it is such an honor to sit down and chat with you. This is
it's fun. You're asking me all the good questions here. You're asking me all. Well, you know, I noticed one of the things that Chris mentioned, somebody wanted to know how about the premieres that you remember or something. Well, I have to tell you one thing about Bernstein. Bernstein never conducted a piece that he didn't believe in thoroughly. And he chose really well. He chose great repertoire. And he liked good composers. He liked Copland, for instance. And he, you know, and his own music. He didn't conduct his own music all that much, actually. He was not selfish that way. But I can remember any Mahler symphony with Bernstein was unbelievable, because I think, based on what I've read that he wrote about Mahler, he considered himself almost a reincarnation of Mahler, being a composer, conductor, pianist. He identified it. You felt that he was going through the compositional process right there in front of you on the podium. He was recreating it. You know, it was so exciting to play with any Mahler symphony with him. And also, my first or second year in the orchestra, we did the Knaben Wunderhorn of Mahler, all those songs. And Krista Ludwig was the mezzo soloist with her husband, Walter Berry, as the baritone. And the two of them, plus Bernstein, this was like watching people composing in front of you. You know, it was just miraculous. I still have the LP record of that. And it's so inspiring to listen to that kind of creation and the love for every single note, you know, a certain quality on every single note that had to be there wasn't good enough. You know, many, many different ways of doing it, and they only could do it the way that they thought it was had to be perfect. And I remember my first year in the orchestra, Bernstein conducted Das Lied von der Erde. You know, you only play Mahler symphonies usually. Now the kids do it in school. But when I started to join the orchestra, I had never played a Mahler symphony because it wasn't done outside of the big orchestras. Because first of all, there's extra instruments, contrabassoon and extra horns and extra percussion. And, you know, and it's every measure is a different tempo. So school orchestras generally didn't do it. So I was just thrilled. And I had never played Das Lied, which some people feel is like Mahler's 10th symphony, even though he had another 10th symphony. But this is like a symphony with voice. Well, the soloist, the male soloist was Fischer Dieskau, who Bernstein absolutely adored. And I was so stunned by the performance. I remember the Friday afternoon concert, I started to cry while we were playing it. And I lost a contact lens, because I wore contact lenses, because I'm very nearsighted. And I lost a contact lens out of one eye, and I had to finish the concert with only one eye. When my partner was very sweet, he understood, and afterwards we looked for the contact lens on the stage, but we couldn't find it. So, you know, I just remember crying during some of Bernstein's performances, because he gave everything, you know, and you couldn't be immune to the force of his personality on the stage. And luckily my stand partner, whether it was Homer or Jimmy, they were very sweet. They didn't mind that I cried, you know, maybe they didn't poke fun at me. They sympathized, you know, offered me a handkerchief, you know, I mean, you know, it just, that's the way everybody felt, whether they admitted it or not, you know? And it's just, you crave those moments. Or Raphael Kubelik with any Janacek. We did a Janacek opera with him that was unbelievable. We did The House of the Dead, which was so incredible. I had never played any Janacek opera before. I don't think most of the orchestra had either, because it's not repertoire that's done every other day. And Kubelik had studied with Janacek, I believe, and when he was growing up, and he knew it and loved every note of it and was so marvelous with it. It was very deeply felt. And then, of course, I envy Chicago Symphony now, because they've got Muti. Muti was the one we wanted 8 years ago, but the manager decided otherwise. We had voted for Muti, and this is something that I couldn't say until now. And maybe bass players will be surprised to hear this, but I know that's how we felt. We thought Muti was probably one of the best, one of the few living conductors that's outstanding. And yeah. that I'm so happy for Chicago that they have him, because I understand they're doing wonderfully.
They are. I've had that. You know, I lived in Chicago for 20
years. Yes, I know. That's where I thought you were until you wrote you were moving to San Francisco. I thought you were staying in Chicago. So you must have gone there, right? You saw a lot of performances.
Yeah, and it was just remarkable to see that's been obviously a great orchestra for a long time. But it was wild.
But they needed someone like Muti to bring out their best.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. What is it about Muti that attracted the Philharmonic members to him? Like,
well, first of all, when Muti conducted us as a guest conductor, we sounded. Suddenly, in one rehearsal, we sounded like the Toscanini recordings that we all cherished, that we all grew up with, and that most of our teachers were influenced by the Toscanini articulation. Well, first of all, let me just give you one example of Muti's care and feeding of orchestras, of what we need. The week before he was due to start rehearsals of an obscure Hindemith opera called Santa Susanna, which I had never heard of. I think there were the three obscure operas from the 1920s that people read about in biographies of Hindemith, but nobody actually heard, you know? And this was one of them. And this was about a nun that falls passionately in love with Jesus on the crucifix. You know, it's very atmospheric. And he had the libretto of the opera put in each of our mailboxes a week before the rehearsal so we would know what was going on. And he coached the singers individually before we started the first rehearsal. He had worked with each of the singers before that. So it was like a finished thing when he stood up in front of us. He obviously loved the piece. And now, you know, Hindemith is a little bit thorny, a little bit difficult. It was staggering. The orchestra just was completely blown away by it. And I got a CD of it because as members of the orchestra were allowed to request from the archives, if they record a broadcast, we can have a copy of it. So I have a copy of that. And because I wanted to relive this excitement, you know, that he brought, well, the precision of it and also the feeling of it. The feeling of each, and this little momentary ripple in the flutes. He said, that is the smell of the almond blossoms outside the convent wall that she smells, and that awakens her joy and love, and the spring, the feelings of spring, the sap rising in the trees, and, you know, and we all, oh my God, you know, it was just, he spoke about the music the way Bernstein used to speak about it, and the way all the great conductors give you an image to think about in some, you know, some more than others. But most of the great ones had some kind of an image that they would give the orchestra, even if it was a very short sentence, something, you know, that just inspired you. You know, like, for instance, one of my students said, you have to come to a Haitink rehearsal at Juilliard. He said, come over as soon as you can. We were just back from a tour, and I just didn't feel like leaving the apartment, you know, for a day or so. He said, you've got to come over. He's rehearsing Brahms second with us. It's so beautiful. You have to see this. You have to hear it. So I came running over there, and Haitink was rehearsing the Juilliard Orchestra in the last movement. And the beginning, you know, that's so softy, so soft and breathless and pianissimo and delicate. And the violins weren't soft enough. They still three or four tries, and finally he leaned over and he said, play this as if you're telling someone a secret. And it was perfect. It was just, it was perfect. And everybody looked at each other. It was like they sounded like the greatest orchestra in the world right then. So things like that, you know, a conductor is able to appeal to the imagination of an orchestra, then they will give him anything. If just one little something like that. Plus, of course, Muti has the kind of baton technique that he should be teaching somewhere, but he isn't. I don't think he teaches. If there's a few videos of him doing some teaching in an Italian conservatory, maybe somebody should watch that, because that's what's not being taught today is the art of conducting, which is much more than just waving your stick in the air, you know? There's millions of words that you could say about every single bar, but that you could have to convey with your hands and your face. And Mupi can do it, but look at his experience. Look at all his experience in opera, 19 years at La Scala, many years of conducting Vienna as a guest, and they love him. They ask him to do the New Year's thing all the time. When they can't, they have to get somebody else. I mean, he's one of their favorites because he's got the goods. He has all the experience. You know, I one of my students brought me a video about an Italian composer that wrote all the background music for Fellini's films, Nino Rota.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Mupi studied piano with Nino Rota in the Bari Conservatory, where Mupi went the first years of his life. He studied piano with him, and he said that Nino Rota was his mentor. He lived in the conservatory. He spent 20 hours a day there with the students and giving piano lessons, giving music lessons, whatever, and he just adored him. He said, that's why I'm a musician today, is because what I learned by studying piano and composition with Nino Rota. Then he went to the Milan Conservatory, and then he graduated, and then he began to conduct. And so, you know, but Mupi still was playing piano for his singers, for coaching his singers. When all the 19 years he worked at La Scala, he didn't use a staff pianist. He accompanied them himself. So, you know, there is somebody who's a real musician and who loves and knows music from the ground up and has so much to give an orchestra. Let me tell you something else. At the Met, he conducted, let me see, an opera. I wish I could think of the title. It's an early Verdi opera, and it sounds sort of like Alessi or Aleko, which is a Rachmaninoff opera. It's one Italian name beginning with A, and I can't think of it right now, but I'll think of it in a minute. And the orchestra was astounded, and I went to the opening night performance. Our piccolo player, Mindy Kaufman, had an extra ticket. So I got the ticket, and I sat with her in a box, which was placed so we could see the conductor. We really didn't care about the stage. We just wanted to watch Mupi at work, because every gesture is precise and means something, and it's it, you know, it's just, and the orchestra was transformed, absolutely sparkling, beautiful, and the chorus, Attila, that was the name, like Attila the Hun,
sure.
You know,
yeah, right,
A-T-I-L-L-A, so, or A-T-T, so the chorus loved working with Mupi so much that I bumped into the chorus master at the stage door, one of the concerts that we were playing with Mupi before the concert, and I saw him, and he said, guess what we did? We went to Tiffany's, and we had a pair of cufflinks engraved with the opening theme of Attila and gave it to Mupi as a gift from the chorus of the Met because we loved working with him. That is the kind of response that he produces in musicians, because he's sort of the last inheritor of the Toscanini way of conducting. That's how I would sum it up. So Chicago is having a wonderful renaissance, and I think I read a couple of years ago, two people gave a total of, together, $32 million to endow his chair. I think I read that in Slip Disc or something, and it just, I mean, that is a result of having someone that the community and the orchestra and everybody understands how great he is, and they're very lucky to have him. But I have to tell you who I like very much. I have to tell you the two people I enjoy working with, conductors. Manfred Honeck is from Vienna, and he's the Pittsburgh music director. And his contract goes until at least 2020, and they might have him longer, too. I'm sure they would like to keep him. He comes to us, and it's electrifying. He makes us sound like the Vienna Philharmonic when he conducts one rehearsal, and suddenly we sound like the Vienna Philharmonic. It's quite something you can't describe because it's mysterious. What a conductor does is mysterious, and generally you either have it or you don't. It's not something you can teach. You can teach technique, but you can't teach the interior power, the inner life that a great conductor has to have. And Honeck has it. And every time he conducts it, it's even better and better and better. And he's young. He's only 50 or something like that. And he played viola in the Vienna Opera and Philharmonic in Vienna for 6 years before he became a conductor. So he has that kind of experience. His brother is one of the several different concertmasters in Vienna. You know, they have several because they have such a busy schedule. He has a very musical family that's born in Vienna and lived there for a long time. So he comes from a tremendous background. He conducted the Fledermaus Overture with us a couple of years ago. And the young kids in the orchestra never saw anything like it because he changed. Every bar had a different tempo, a different nuance, a different pause, a different accelerando, a different something. They never saw anything like that. And by the end of the week, we were playing that way. first rehearsal was very difficult because we were not used to turning on a dime the way he wanted us to, the way Bernstein used to conduct. He used to say the Philharmonic is wonderful. They can change on a dime, change styles on a dime. But with Honeck, he demands that of us, and it's wonderful. It's wonderful because by the end of the week, it's like, why can't we sound like this all the time? And the other one is a wonderful Russian conductor named Vladimir Jurovsky, who made his debut at the Met in his 20s and has grown and grown and grown, and now he's in his 40s, and he's got the most perfect baton technique you ever saw. He also should be teaching somewhere. If I had it all to do over again, I would take conducting classes, but not conduct. I just watch. I would just watch and study, because that's the fascination to me, is you look at a conductor and you can't really figure out what it is that's so marvelous, except you know who has it and who doesn't. And it's amazing the change in an orchestra's sound just from the way somebody comes and walks and stands on the podium. It's already clear. You know, it's amazing. It's just, that's one of the fun things about playing in an orchestra, I have to say.
Yeah.
It's really great.
Well, magic, it's just like, it really is kind of like this.
It is. It's like a magician.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It is like a magician. And there's something you cannot explain. Well, do you know, I never had the privilege and pleasure of playing with Carlos Kleiber, but the Met guys told me about him. And what he was like, oh my God, the Philharmonic Orchestra, when we had an artistic committee for the first time in 1974, the first conductors we asked for from the management to hire was Carlos Kleiber. He had just made his first recording with Vienna of Beethoven's Fifth. We heard that recording. We all agreed we have to work with this man. And the answer came back. Our manager said he wants 5 rehearsals and we only give 4 a week. And we can't afford that. So sorry, you can't have him. So I was so disappointed because I thought if we had started a relationship with him when he was very young at that time, then maybe we would have him conduct once a year. You know, if only even once a year would be something wonderful, because he conducted 4 operas at the Met and they still talk about it. In fact, some of the musicians that didn't have to play put on their tuxedos and went and sat in the pit the night that he was conducting so they could see him work. I mean, what does that tell you about a conductor?
Right.
You know?
Right.
Nobody gives up their night off. Nobody, you know? But this is, I mean, I went standing room for one of the operas because I couldn't get a seat. And next to me was standing the first cello, Jerry Grossman, who used to play in the Philharmonic in the early 70s. He was in our orchestra for a few years. And I said, Jerry, what are you doing? He says, I got to see this guy. I got to see this guy. I played with him last week, and now I have to see him play the other opera. Just absolutely magic that you want to be around something like that. You know, you want to feel that wonderful feeling of this person has this magic quality that lifts you up, you know, and you understand more about music when you listen to him, when you work with him, you understand whatever it is you're playing. Oh, I never thought of that. You know, it opens something new up for you, which is something terrific. You played Beethoven's Fifth for 100 times, and then you play it with somebody like that. Oh, my goodness, yeah. I never heard that before,
right.
You know?
Talk about, like, one of my all-time favorite music. I've watched every video I could ever find of him, and I've read, there's a great book.
Of Kleiber?
Of Kleiber. There's a great book of letters between Kleiber and someone who just befriended
him. And someone who just kept writing him, and he answered him back.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yes, I saw that book. Yeah. I borrowed it from a friend of mine. Yeah. I read a lot of it.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
It's
beautiful.
Fascinating. Yeah.
Fascinating, really. Mm-hmm. And when you realize he always was comparing himself to his father.
Yeah.
You know, by the way, one of the other things about the old Philharmonic members, a lot of them were artists, including Fred Zimmerman. Fred Zimmerman used to come home from a concert and paint until 3 in the morning. He also used to draw sketches of conductors on the blank pages in the music, which are now in the archives. And one of the violists when I joined, a guy named Ray Sabinski, used to draw sketches of everybody, of conductors, of his fellow musicians, all on the blank pages in whatever part you had. So there, I think a lot of those things are in the archives now. I'm glad they saved them because they used to take sketchbooks instead of cameras with them on tour. They took sketchbooks and made sketches of wherever they visited, you know. So that was old-fashioned, but it was very artistic, you know. A lot of people in the article, in fact, I'm thinking of a sketch of Carlos Kleiber's father, Eric Kleiber, in the 30s that Zimmerman had, I think on one of the things that he had hanging up in his apartment, he made a sketch of him, and then he gave him a copy or something like that, you know, gave Kleiber a copy. You know, just a quick little pencil sketch of just a quick impression of a personality, which is quite wonderful if somebody can draw. I can't draw, so of course I admire somebody who could draw tremendously, but that's something also that Kleiber did little things. He used to send little notes to people in the orchestra of whatever he was conducting. His son, Carlos, used to send something which they called Kleibergrams, you know, where yeah. he would say, 20 measures after letter B, could you make that note a little more staccato or something like that? You know, he would send that. After a performance, he would send those little notes to people in the orchestra. Never mean, always just a little suggestion about how to do something better. So, you know, people saved those notes.
And it was just, I mean, if ever there was a conductor where you'd watch, well, I mean, Bernstein's in that category, certainly, too, but like,
exactly.
Carlos Kleiber is music. I mean, you can see
he
Beethoven
is, 5. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I've seen the videos of him with Concertgebouw, I think, a Beethoven 4th, and I can't remember, Beethoven 4th and 7th, I think, the two Beethoven symphonies. And very often, like Bernstein, he'll stand still and won't do anything. You know, and just let the orchestra keep time by themselves, which makes them listen and watch him even more, you know. I think there's a video of Bernstein conducting the Vienna Philharmonic in Haydn 88, and he lets them do the last movement as an encore without conducting, just looking at them. And the camera shows his face, and it shows the orchestra reacting. And it's, you know, it's such a vote of confidence and security on the part of a conductor to do that. Wonderful. It's like mind control. I'm controlling you with my mind, which is what a conductor does, basically, the good ones.
Yeah.
They don't have to wave their arms that much, you know.
Well, and I think that's why people that aren't in music are so fascinated by conductors and that connection and like when it works.
What do they actually do? What
right.
are they doing?
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Well, you know, sometimes I have been asked by a philharmonic donor group, if I'll go and I will have dinner with a group of donors, you know, and I find some of the questions when they say, well, what do conductors really do? So I tell them, well, would you rather have Laurence Olivier or Burt Reynolds play Hamlet? That's the difference between a bad conductor and a good conductor.
That's a good
if you idea. Would like, you know, that's the difference. If you, and a great director of a theater or a film, the great director is what makes the difference. You know, you have a bunch of actors that are well trained, they can do, but you know, you need someone to organize it all and to be telling you certain things about the way you need to coordinate what you're doing. And this is a great conductor has all the qualities of a great actor and a great director. But I think that, I don't know if you're a fan of Laurence Olivier. I was when I was a teenager. That was my hero. And I think he's a lot better than Burt Reynolds.
I think so, too.
At least for the classic repertoire, you know. I mean, Burt might have been fun in comedies, but right. I think for Shakespeare, you can't beat Laurence Olivier.
Yeah.
And you can't beat Bernstein for Mahler or even Beethoven. You know, Bernstein had a very high respect for Beethoven, too. And his Beethovens were very, very exciting and dramatic and romantic rather than classical, which is fine, you know, for that kind of conducting. That's fine for that. So was Nickish romantic. So was so many of the older conductors were very romantic. Bruno Walter was romantic. Was less classical than Toscanini. It's kind of interesting, but we have to have both.
Orin, I can't even begin to thank you for sitting down and chatting with me. We could have gone on for several more hours. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much. And I know that everybody out there appreciates you taking the time and chatting. And this is the sort of thing that makes me so excited to do this podcast. Wow, what a cool opportunity to sit down and chat with Orin for a couple hours about Leonard Bernstein, about Riccardo Muti, about all these specific excerpts, about just the whole evolution of the bass through the second half of the 20th century. I mean, it's phenomenal. I don't know what to say. And I just want to thank you. This might be the first time you've ever listened to this podcast. Guess what? We've hit almost 400 episodes. We're going to hit 400 episodes this week. I can't believe we're at 400 episodes. And we're not slowing down. I have so many more conversations in store. Can't wait to keep diving into all these topics with all these people. And the way I get ideas for these shows, who to feature, what style of show to do, it's from listeners. It's from you. So I would love to hear from you. You can write me at feedback@contrabassconversations.com. Give me a suggestion for a guest, anything, or just say hi. I'm very friendly. I will respond. You can hit us up on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all that kind of good stuff. And if you haven't explored the site, my partner in crime over here at Contrabass Conversations, Trevor Jones, he and I are working hard on all sorts of things behind the scenes, trying to make the site more useful, working on the bass blog. We've got a lot of great projects in store. Can't wait to talk about those in about 2 weeks. I got some really exciting new news. But thank you for following along. Share this with your friends. I guarantee you, I say this a lot, but it's totally true. I guarantee you that most bass players do not listen to this show. A fraction of bass players. A lot of people listen to this show, but I guarantee you, if you're on a gig and you look to your left and you look to your right, it's more than likely that neither of those people have listened to the show. So if you want to help us out and continue to grow and continue to do things of service to the bass community, next time you're on a gig, turn to your left and say, hey, you know about Contrabass Conversations? Turn to your right, do the same thing, get the army even larger than it is. That would be so wonderful. And share this out on social media. Share it on Facebook. Share it on YouTube, I guess, if you can somehow. Share it on Instagram, whatever. That is super helpful. Thank you for listening. It was so great to chat with Orin. I hope you had a great time. I totally appreciate it. I know Orin does too. And we will see you again soon for more life on the low end of the spectrum.